Hey, welcome back to another episode of Razorback Reels. I'm Adam Roberts.
And I'm Aaron Emsall.
We missed you the last couple weeks, so we have a show full of reviews that you need to pay attention to. So stay with us. Got a good mix of films this week to review at some comedies, dramas, yeah. Horrors, everything.
And the ones I saw, I actually pretty much liked all of them for the most part.
Oh, well,
so we'll start off with the new Clint Eastwood movie, Changeling.
My name is Christine Collins. On March 10th, my 9-year-old son, Walter Collins, disappeared. And a 5-month investigation led to a boy being brought to Los Angeles from DeKalb, Illinois. The LAPD told me and all of you that this boy was my son. He was not my son.
All right, there's the new Clint Eastwood movie starring Angelina Jolie, Changeling. And you've probably seen this preview many times if you know anything about this, where she's like, I want my son. And this movie kind of makes you think it's going to be this big thriller, crime thriller. And that's it. But really, this is more of a period drama set in the late 1920s, early 30s. And I really think it does a good job of not only portraying the atmosphere of the late 1920s, early 30s, but also kind of the attitudes of both the the battle for this patriarchal, you know, power from Angelina Jolie and how she's trying to, you know, empower herself as a single woman. And it does a good job of kind of just giving you this feeling of the era. And I really enjoyed Angelina Jolie's performance in this. I mean, sometimes she has a tendency just to kind of act with her certain looks. Like, she'll give out these certain kind of glares and looks and kind of relies on that maybe a little too much. But I really liked her performance. And I really think Clint Eastwood did a really good job as far as the pacing with this story. The movie never gets predictable throughout the whole time. You don't really know what's going to happen, despite really going in, maybe seeing the preview, thinking you know everything that's going to happen. You know, oh, it's not my son, it's my son. Such this, but you know, Adam, I really liked this movie, and I thought it had a good story. Mm-hmm. I liked the pacing of it, and I think it's amazing how they were able to do the locations and really make it recreate 1928 Los Angeles.
So, do you think maybe Oscar buzz for Angelina Jolie?
Whether they deserve it or not, I definitely think she's gonna get a nomination. I mean, I really think she brought this. I mean, there's not that many strong female roles anymore.
Not yet, at least.
A lot of people complain about that. You know, for the most part, is every year they're
Meryl
struggling.
Meryl Streep every year, yeah.
Yeah, they're struggling to find a strong female role, which Meryl Streep will probably be nominated for Doubt as well, because that's another strong look like a strong female
not
role.
Not Mamma Mia.
Yeah, not Mamma Mia. But I mean, she's a very strong role in this. She does a good job at this. I mean, I sometimes don't like that look in her eye, that she like tries to rely on that look too much. But I really like this movie. I think it's one of the best this year so far. Outside of maybe the comedies, but inside of the more dramas.
I'll have to look at it.
I give it a high
days.
Recommendation.
Well, movie I saw was The Haunting of Molly Hartley.
Mom?
Honey, come pray with me. Pray.
Me, I have sin.
Close your eyes, Mom. I can save you.
911, what's your emergency? Are you there? Hello? Hello?
Molly Hartley's senior year was a chance to start over.
Must be hard being new at school.
All right, The Haunting of Molly Hartley is a PG-13 horror movie. It follows the story of a girl who, you know, is going to a new school and she's seeing all these crazy things and you don't know if she's crazy or if this is really happening. And, I mean, I gave the movie a C- because acting isn't really very good and PG-13 horror movies always have to straddle that line between being, you know, too boring and not being too gory for the kids to still see. But it was a lot better than I expected going into it. The story moves slowly enough that you don't get bored, but still slowly enough that there's suspense. They don't give away all the twists until the end. And this is, I just want to say, I mean, I don't know how many Hollywood executives watch this show. I'm sure there are plenty. But please, when you do a trailer, don't spoil the ending of the movie. I didn't show that in the trailer or the clip of the trailer that we just showed here on Razorback Reels. But in the trailer you saw at the theaters, it gives away the last 5 minutes of the movie where you have this twist, and it was so disappointing because I think I would have enjoyed this movie much more if I hadn't seen the trailer. It was just very frustrating.
Yeah, well, I think I'm pretty much morally opposed to PG-13 horror movies that try to take the edge on in between, rated R and PG-13. I didn't see the movie, but I'm actually kind of interested because I actually are able to enjoy somewhat most horror movies. So I might catch this one because it looked kind of freaky.
Compared to something like Prom Night, which we had earlier in this
which
year,
which was horrible.
This was light years better than Prom Night.
That's good to know.
If your mom won't let you go see a rated R movie and you want to see something scary for, I guess Halloween's over now, but still want to see something to scare you, I would say go ahead and see this with some of your friends, but don't expect anything great out of it.
Well, it's got a good 90210 cast and a good ode to them and the guy from Gossip Girl, so good deal there.
Of course, Molly Hartley went head-to-head against the second week of High School Musical 3.
And lost.
Come here, you'll love it.
Take my hand, take a breath. Pull me close and take one step. Keep your eyes locked on mine and let the music be your.
All right. Now, I'm not Roger Ebert, so I'm just going to level with you. At the beginning of my review, I didn't see the entire movie. There was about half an hour left when I found out that they were about to screen Zach and Miri make a porno, so I left the theater and went over to see that instead.
Good choice.
Yeah, but I mean, this is, if you like the first two High School Musicals, you're going to like this one. It has all the same strengths and all the same weaknesses as the other two. The plot's a little bit predictable. It's sappy, as you saw obviously there, but the cast is great, has a lot of great energy. And I always think that it's sort of Bollywood for Americans because you have the same, there's almost no kissing in any of the three movies. You have the wild dance numbers, everything in a high school. I think these movies are a lot of fun, even if they're not that great. But part of the problem is that High School Musical was just fantastic for the Disney Channel. Oh. And for a theater, it's not so great because you have slightly higher standards in a movie theater than you do on the Disney Channel. So I don't know how many people that went to see this loved it as much as they would if it had been released on cable television where it broke lots of records when High School Musical 2 was released. This, of course, did break the record for highest grossing weekend for a musical, just almost doubling Mamma Mia's record, which it set earlier in the year.
That was last week, and it won again this week as well. All I know is you can't stop High School Musical 3. You can only hope to contain High School Musical 3. But the thing that put me off about this movie was that Zac Efron had to have someone teach him how to play basketball because he said he had never played basketball before.
That's all right. I mean, I don't expect Fred Astaire to know how to play basketball.
No, I expect Zac Efron to have dribbled a basketball before. But
he's dribbled.
But what's the matter? They're rolling in the movie.
I think all these actors could do well, and I think, I can't remember her name, the actress who plays Sharpay. I think she was the best one of the entire cast.
No comment.
And
haven't seen
it. I wish she would get some more roles going on. Zac Efron's pretty good, but she's a lot better.
Well, good luck with that. maybe you can get your dream come true one day with that, Adam.
And if you're the type of kid who doesn't really go for High School Musical 3, maybe you like crunchy numbers, the movie for you is IOUSA.
Another $1 trillion in miscellaneous items, and you get $53 trillion. Our country would need $53 trillion invested today, which is about $175,000 per person, to deliver on the government's obligations and promises. How much of this $53 trillion do we have? Zip.
Ross Perot is not part of this movie, but it certainly seems like he would have been. This is a documentary about all of our country's budget problems. We have came up with four different deficits, like the trade deficit, the budget deficit, the debt, and then leadership deficit, they call it. And now, I have really mixed feelings about this. I gave it a C because it's not a great movie, but I still think everybody should see it anyway. This movie does a fantastic job of explaining very complex issues in a way that is very easy for people like me to understand, somebody, who is really bad in math and has never taken an economics class. So I really recommend this to people going in to see it. It doesn't take a partisan slant. Once in a while, I'd be like, oh, great, he's about to start going Pat Buchanan on me. But no, instead the film would just be completely fair. It shows the problems that we could have with China without getting into xenophobia. And so I really think that it's important to see this movie, even though it is really just a glorified PowerPoint presentation. It's not an inconvenient truth, it's not gonna hit you in the heart, but it's going to explain issues that you need to know about in a way that, honestly, nobody's going to sit down and research if they don't have it in this sort of format. So think of it more as economics problems for dummies than a really good movie to go see for fun.
Well, I really wanted to see this, and I'm kind of sad that I missed this one, because of all the movies I missed, this was the one I wanted to see the most, because I've actually heard really good stuff about it. So, you know, I'm glad to see that it was a good, fair presentation of both sides. But on the other hand, the next movie we have, Religious, not so much.
Once.
I'm writing a story. Hero detective captures killer.
All right, that was not the clip for Religious.
That was Pride and Glory.
That was Pride and Glory, which neither of us saw. Don't bother to go see it. Nobody liked it. That's our quick review of a movie we've never seen. But on to Religious. It's Bill Maher's comedian. You may have seen him from his HBO show, Real Time with Bill Maher. And he goes around, it has the same director as Borat, travels across the country doing sort of this stick about religion. Yeah, here's some clips right here.
He will.
He will? Yeah, what's he waiting for?
And then you have Bill Maher right there. He's interviewing a tour guide from some Bible theme,
the Holy Land in Orlando.
In Orlando, Florida. And that's really my biggest problem with this.
There's our esteemed Senator Mark Pryor.
I mean, he'll grab Mark Pryor, who'll grab a tour guide, and he'll ask him all these philosophical questions, but he won't go after anybody with an actual background in theology or philosophy. And I gave a only slightly better review to it, Spell, because they both have the same problems. I've seen this documentary so many times. You take an interview, cut out the parts that makes your interviewee look stupid, and then right after that, show some file footage of World War II. And I've seen this so many times, it's boring me. Bill Maher is funnier than Ben Stein, but at least Ben Stein got Richard Dawkins. Bill Maher doesn't get anybody I've heard of except for Mike Pryor.
I disagree. This movie was a funny movie. I really thought this movie was high comedy. I didn't, you know, Bill Maher comes across as a complete a-hole in this movie. He goes after everybody, you know, and doesn't try to be partisan, doesn't try to be like, well, let me be fair to your point. No, he doesn't care about that. And I just thought, I mean, the cut to Jonah Hill when they were describing about Jesus in the teenage years. Okay. There were some great comedic moments in this. And some of the parts made me go, you know, like, oh, okay, you know, I'm a Christian, so I'm like, oh, you know, I feel, oh, but you know, I know he's not bringing the facts all the time. He doesn't back up his work necessarily. He likes to find his slant, and he sticks with his slant all the way through. But I thought he did in the spirit of what created and promoted by Michael Moore, of his own slanted bias documentary.
Bill Maher is not Michael Moore.
I'm not saying he's Michael Moore, but it's in the spirit of that, where you take these comedic bits in order to get your point across.
Well, that's like Molly Hartley is in the spirit of Rosemary's Baby. That doesn't mean that they're anywhere near
equality. It's a lot closer than you want to make it there.
If you like Bill Maher, you'll probably really like this movie, but if you like comedians who spend more time focusing on jokes than to trying to make themselves look smart, then you probably
won't
like this
movie. What's with the comedy goalie over here? What's wrong with some jokes and some fun?
Nothing's wrong with that.
It was funny stuff.
I laughed quite a few times during this movie, but the laugh per joke ratio was very low.
I disagree. I thought it was funny
the whole time. I mean, even his Scientology stick, which is, you know, just ripe for comedic gold, I was just sitting there like, all right, South Park just did this. The exact same thing. He's practically reading the script from South Park. It wasn't even funny.
Well, like Borat's Larry Charles Borat, you know, they concentrate on making people look stupid that were already, you know, possibly on that way to being stupid. And that's what this movie did. They went after people that weren't prepared, weren't ready to go after them, and they just made them look stupid. The guys in the trucker chapel, you know, the reformed homosexual preacher guy. They made all these people look stupid. The Holy Land Kingdom, you know, there was all these scenarios where these people, him standing, you know, in Jerusalem, and I thought it was very entertaining. I was entertained throughout the whole film. It had my attention the whole way through.
This is the only one that we actually both saw, so we're disagreeing on that.
That's right. We had to find something there.
Your last review.
I was highly entertained. Yeah, my last review is the Saw 58. I mean, Saw 5.
Not yet.
Hello and welcome. Today, 5 will become 1 with a common goal of survival. You are all connected. A cable runs through your collar devices. It can be pulled so tight that you will be decapitated on the mounted razors. The only way to remove the collar is with the keys from the glass boxes on the pedestals before you. Let the games begin.
All right, Saw 5, starring Peter O'Toole, Anthony Hopkins, and Helen Mirren. Oh, wait, that's not Saw 5. This stars Tobin Bell as Jigsaw. So, he's, guess what? Yeah, he's still the main star of the movie. He may be dead and have his face scalpeled off, but he's still the main star using the greatness of flashbacks and new accomplices that set everything up just before he died. And
so, how is this different from any of the other Saws?
It's different people, different new actors, and some of the same. It's really not much different.
All right.
If you like that formula, and you like the formula of the previous Saws, I rank it about Saw 3 level, about as good as Saw 3. Okay. So.
Well, Larry Mueller, the owner of the Utah Jazz, loves to censor movies. He kept Saw 5 in his theater, but here's the movie he wouldn't let be shown. Zach and Miri Make a Porno.
Me and Miri's 10-year high school reunion, I'm just going to get alcohol poisoning.
So why are you going there?
Miri's making me go.
Listen to him. Why are you always bending over backwards for that girl, knowing she ain't giving up no
one? Get a good thing going, man. She pays half the rent, she does dishes, she wakes me up in the morning. Why complicate that with sex? Besides, man, I've known her since the first grade. You know someone you met in the first grade?
Excuse me, I met my wife in kindergarten. We got married senior year, and she has been the queen of my world ever since.
But what if you could do it all over again?
I would live by myself. That woman is the bane of my existence.
See?
All right, there you have Craig Robinson from The Office and Seth Rogen in the scene. I mean, obviously, you could tell I had to edit a lot out, and that was probably the cleanest few lines of dialogue in the entire movie. It's very raunchy. I thought this movie was hilarious for the first hour. In the last half hour, Kevin Smith just kind of throws in the bucket and says, let's just make a regular old romantic comedy. And that's where it lost me.
Well, I think he always makes romantic comedy, so they didn't lose me at all. I actually enjoyed the romantic comedy edge of it. I thought he blended it well with the raunchiness. I mean, he always has that over-the-edge moment that you're not quite ready for, and this movie definitely delivered
wow,
that.
Yeah.
And I wasn't ready for it. I agree. That was definitely over the edge for me. So, it was very funny. It had a lot of funny moments. And I like the romantic comedy part. I think some of the raunchiness doesn't have to be there.
I didn't think it fit. I thought that the audience who's going to see this movie isn't going to appreciate the Disney Channel sap.
No, if you like Kevin Smith, if you're a Kevin Smith fan, you expect that by now.
We'll move on to a trivia question before a short break. It's election day tomorrow, so we're going to ask, what was Ronald Reagan's last movie?
Oh, it was such a heartwarming film about two brothers and a boy and his father.
But they really represent sort of the neo-existentialist way of thinking.
Last movie that Ronald Reagan appeared in was The Killers back in 1964.
Yeah, and he was a ruthless killer in it. Nothing like seeing Ronald Reagan as a real villain in a non-political manner there, at least. So.
Oh, I liked Reagan. Come on.
I like Reagan somewhat, too.
I'm thinking Michael Moore films. That's what we're... Well, about 24 hours from now, we will have the election returns coming in. We probably already know how a few races are going to turn out, but we'll refrain from already announcing a winner on UATV.
We got a winner. Oh, wait. No, we don't.
And we're ready to call the election for Barack Obama. Oh, first person on UATV to do that. All
right. That's right.
Well, we're just going to go through a few of our political favorites from Hollywood. One of my favorite movies of all time is Mr. Smith Goes to Washington.
All you people don't know about lost causes. Mr. Payne does.
This is, of course, Frank Capra's movie starring Jimmy Stewart as the senator who moves in the Senate. He's sort of the outsider. Nobody really thinks he knows what's going on. Sort of the Sarah Palin of 1939.
Kind
of. And, you know, he stands up against corruption. He's got, you know, this great monologue. And this is really just a classic. 1939 is packed with great movies. And this is one that you absolutely have to see. This is probably Jimmy Stewart at his finest in his career.
Yeah, this is a wonderful movie. It's also one of my favorites. You know, it's a movie from the late 30s as well, so this is a movie that really brings the punch, and it's really got, you know, a great, it's this naive guy from, was he from Wyoming or Montana? I always get confused. Doing the boy summer camp, and you know, he's the country bumpkin, and man, he's so pure in this and so wonderful.
Right.
You're just cheering him on in his socialist ways, you know, throughout the whole way. But no, it's a really good movie, and it's Frank Capra at his finest.
And the thing
I agree.
Is, like, this was, I mean, now it's all like, oh, warm and gooey Frank Capra, but back then it was a really controversial movie,
yeah.
And they had investigations to find out if Jimmy Stewart was a communist because of this movie. Word that was giving, you know, aid and comfort to the enemy by showing Americans as corrupt, you know, which of course would not be true at all. The Senate would corrupt? What?
Never happened.
No.
Didn't exist.
Speaking of political corruption, our next film comes from 1976, All the President's Men.
Yeah, and All the President's Men is based on the Woodward and Bernstein book that was all about Watergate and Richard Nixon's foray into darkness because of it and his resignation. And this kind of shows the background with the journalist Deep Throat and the informants of Deep Throat and how the journalists got their scoops and how it all unfolded. And it really shows, you know, how these two kind of nobody journalists, you know, working on the bottom level, kind of went up the top level and became household names.
Yeah, Dustin Hoffman and Robert Redford. And this is just, it's just a terrific movie. And I mean, it is the political conspiracy thriller, and it's true. So it just makes it even better.
And journalistic movie. It's a great movie for journalism majors and people going to journalism because it kind of exposes the whole 70s feel. I mean, we're not like that at all today, but it's
one of the very few movies that actually portrays journalists in a positive light.
That's right. It's not scumbags. That's right.
Right. It'd be nice to see if we do a movie where cops are the good guys
that's
for
right.
once.
But yeah, I really like All the President's Men. It's one of my favorites from the 70s.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want to give away the ending, but it turns out the president has something to do with it.
Nixon may be in trouble.
After all. Yeah, I wonder what happens to him.
We'll see in the new December movie, Frost vs. Nixon or whatever.
Well, speaking of Dustin Hoffman and political conspiracy movies, we have Wag the Dog from 1997. And, you know, IO USA came out at a great time when everyone's worried about a financial crisis. Wag the Dog was just perfect with release timing.
Exactly.
It came out like the week that the Monica Lewinsky scandal broke out, like a few days before that it officially broke out on the major news networks.
So what happened?
Well, in Wag the Dog, what happens is the president is caught up in a sex scandal in the Oval Office, and so in order to distract everybody, he decides to create a fictitious war and bomb some countries, and so in this scene right here, we have Robert De Niro and Dustin Hoffman trying to plan how they're going to set up this fake war to distract everybody from the set scandal.
You mean that's what happened with President Clinton?
Which one was I talking about? I can't
I
remember.
I don't know. It doesn't matter because it's the same.
You know, this is when Clinton decided to bomb that hospital in Sudan and somewhere in Afghanistan.
Yeah, going medicine after, factory.
Yeah, going after some guy named Osama bin something. I don't really know what that was all about. And so that, you know, it came out, this was huge news. People were really buying into the conspiracy theory. And hey, this fits in right with the Bush administration too.
Yeah, it does very much so. And I actually don't love this movie. I liked it all right. I enjoyed it. But it's more relevant for the time than anything and really becomes politically relevant when you look back at the history right to down to the timeline. So.
I mean, I think it's hilarious. It's spot on satire, especially with Willie Nelson's whole song. He does that good old shoe.
Willie Nelson is great. And that's probably the best part of the movie, in my opinion.
All right. Well, HBO just released a film on DVD.
Yeah, earlier this year, Recount. And Recount is all about the Florida 2000 election and what happened there with Catherine Harris. And there's some incredible performances. And I've been on the record on Razorback Reels as being down with Kevin Spacey. But in my opinion, Kevin Spacey was terrific in this role, as playing as one of Al Gore's former, I think, chief of staff or something. I can't remember exactly. But he was fired and then brought back to be the lead the campaign to try to win Al Gore, and it kind of shows this, you know, battle between them, and both sides pretty much say it's partisan, you know, and they nobody, either the Republicans or Democrats had a problem with this movie being made. So whenever you hear that, you got to think,
wow,
maybe this movie is pretty close to the truth. What makes you think that probably right now I'd be driving an electric car if things had gone how maybe they were supposed to. I'm not driving an electric car.
It's just so strange to look back at history. I mean, we think about all these grand events moving around, but when you look at just these tiny little contingencies, if, you know, 300 people in Florida had actually punched the hole all the way through, I mean, we had no idea what anybody's life would be like nowadays.
I mean, everybody knows it was close. Everybody knows that it came down, you know. I mean, it was in court for a long time. But this movie makes you think, wow, it was beyond close. It was it was over on the other side, and it just, political reasons, it merely got stopped. And there's some really good performances. Like I said, besides Kevin Spacey, Dennis Leary does a good job in this, and many more. But I really enjoy this movie. It's made by HBO, not a theater movie, but it's terrific. It's directed by the guy, Jay Roach, that did Meet the Fockers and Meet the Parents. So,
interesting.
Yeah, he directed that. It was originally supposed to be directed
by Ben Stiller comedy, right?
No, yeah, it's kind of like Tropic Thunder, but
I get it.
Sidney Pollack was originally supposed to direct it, but he got too sick and he had to pull out, and so it was his project to begin with.
I mean, HBO's done some great stuff. They had that John Adams miniseries, won an Emmy, or a few Emmys, I guess.
And especially with how this election may have its own lawsuits, who knows, in close states.
I hope so. For, you know, as a journalist, I really hope it'll be dragged out as long as possible.
Check this movie out on DVD, because it's extremely relevant. You got till tomorrow, so hurry up.
All right. Well, I suppose we'll just wrap things up. What do we have next?
Next week, we got Role Models, which I think looks really funny.
Madagascar 2 and Soul Man with
Bernie
Mac and Samuel L. Jackson.
Bernie Mac's last performance, maybe, I think. I think this was his last performance before he died.
I think so. Now, Isaac Hayes has a small role in it, too.
So it's two people that this will be their last performances. So we'll see. It looks good.
All right. So we'll, of course, have that and our DVD picks next week. So please stay tuned. Be sure to vote tomorrow if you haven't already. And after you vote, go see a movie at AMC Theaters for $4 on Tuesday.
Tuesday night, go after ahead. The election, hey. When it's in the bag already by somebody.
I mean, if you wear your I Voted sticker, then
it's $4.
You don't get anything special, but hey. All right, well, for Razorback Reels, I'm Adam Roberts.
And I'm Aaron Imsall.
Entertainment, fashion, and Hollywood gossip. Tuesdays at 7 on UATV. Razorback Transit. Come on and take a free ride.
Wednesdays at 7 on UATV.